semesters of effort by a group of seniors who started out the beginning of last semester designing an airplane that was intended to fly 300 nautical miles in 6 hours or less nonstop for pipeline surveillance. We split this group up into two teams, and both teams competed and presented designs at the end of last semester that were reviewed by a group of panelists like you guys, and together with the panelists, I selected one of the designs to go forward into this semester to be further designed and then built and flown, which is the resulting aircraft over here. So one of the major challenges of this semester was getting two teams that were former adversaries to come together and work as one. The teamwork effort required to make that happen was considerable. There was a lot of clashing going on, as you can imagine. The one team that had a really good aircraft that wasn't selected, there were some hurt feelings there, and the other team naturally felt a little superior, so there was a lot of leveling going on in this. So a lot of this, the challenges that happened within this design were not necessarily technical in nature, but in terms of human interaction, teamwork, communication, and all of the dynamics that go along with that. So I applaud this team for really coming together and being able to do something that was really, really challenging given that culture and environment. So I'm gonna hand this off to Cobra Rondeau, who was the team lead, who will take you guys through the presentation. So Cobra, here you go.
Good morning, everyone. We are Inspect Air, and today we'll be presenting the final design review for Project Corvus. So, as you said, my name is Cobra Rondeau, and I'm the design team lead. I'll be introducing our team. We have the deputy design team lead, Kendall Jones. We have our chief engineer, Chris Reed. We have our supply chain, Esteban Cortez. We have our test engineers, Joanna Moore and Charles Manning. We have our integral systems team lead, Aiden Bramer, and working with him, we have Monish Tripathi and Carlos Ojita Palma. We have our production and structural engineer team lead, Garrett Sheets. And working with him, we have Jonathan Mikre, Sean Lemarena, Kevin Brown, Aravind Srikumar, and Jonathan Stinson. Thank you. Slide, please. So for our presentation overview today, we'll be going over our preliminary design analysis, the structural production and assembly of our aircraft, and then our flight test results. I'll now hand it off to Christopher Reed to talk about our project introduction.
All right, so we started off with a statement of need provided by El Paso Natural Gas Company, and they were looking for a better way to inspect their pipeline that's more cost efficient, safer, and better than flying it with a Cessna 185 with two people on board. The design solution for this statement of need can be applied across the nation to save millions of dollars for all of the pipeline companies. Next slide, please. So our request for proposal resulted in our Project Corvus, which is sitting over here to my left, and you're all on the table to your right. It has a crew of two, technically, one pilot at the takeoff and one pilot at the landing, but it is autonomous for the duration of its flight. The unit price is only $91,000, which includes all of the manufacturing, labor hours, and material cost that goes into it, including the $20,000 camera that would be required to inspect the pipeline. The yearly operation cost is only $3,200 to inspect a pipeline of 300 miles once a month. And the total cost for 10 years is $127,550, which is approximately $200,000 less than using a Cessna 185 for the same mission. Next slide, please. Our key requirements. In order to meet what we needed to do, we had to fly over 300 nautical miles in a 6 hour time frame with a 55 pound maximum weight UAV. The other requirements ensured that it would meet the it would be able to make the flight under any conditions. Next slide, please. For our concept of operations, we had a pilot set up the aircraft in Tucson, Arizona, where he would do a controlled takeoff into the air, at which point he would switch over to an autopilot that would follow GPS waypoints all the way along the pipeline route in blue, and that would gather information using an infrared and visible spectrum camera. The infrared camera would look for leaks in the pipeline, and the visual spectrum camera would be able to identify nearby landmarks to have a ground crew clearly define the leak point. The GPS and altimeter are used to fly at 74 knots true airspeed and 400 foot above ground level at a constant rate across the pipeline. That includes with wind operation and any kind of slight variations in terrain. The onboard program detects the leaks and records them on board, at which point a second pilot waiting in El Paso, Texas, will take control of the aircraft and land the aircraft in an open runway or an open field. The pilot will retrieve the data that was collected and report it to El Paso Natural Gas for any leaks. It will then be stowed in El Paso, Texas, for a return flight the following month back to Tucson, Arizona. Next slide, please. For Project Orbis, we predicted a lot of performance parameters, all of which met the requirements provided by El Natural Gas Company. The actual performance that we discovered in our flight testing was not quite 100% accurate, but we got all of the values that we needed, and all of them were within bounds that we expected and met the requirements as well. Joanna will talk about the actual flight test later and discuss what the values came from and how they met our requirements. One requirement of note was that our takeoff weight was predicted to be 44.5 pounds, and once we actually built the aircraft, it ended up being 44 pounds. So that's kind of a notable change, where most teams or most projects will start off with a fairly reasonable weight, and then as it's getting built, it'll end up going way above that weight. We made a very accurate assessment on what our weight would be by the end of our prelim semester, and we ended up with a plane that matched that prediction, down to half a pound. Next slide, please. The scope of our prototype was that it would have a simulated mass inside for the payload, a simplified avionics package, and it would use a much more powerful but different power plant that is carbureted instead of fuel injected and much less efficient than the actual power plant used in our production model. It's more of a proof of concept to show that it is controllable in flight and is able to meet the requirements. I can show you our skin removed. The yellow is our simulated payload, and the rest of the wiring and batteries are the simplified avionics. Next slide. I will now hand it off to Jonathan Stinson to discuss the wind tunnel results.
So, next slide, please. So before I go over any of our wind tunnel results, I'm just going to go over a quick overview of the aerodynamic design of Project Corvus. It utilizes a Clark Y airfoil and a rectangular wing with a 10-foot span and a 12-inch cord. The empennage of the aircraft was taken from a previous detail team, and specifications of that are provided on the lower half of the chart for your reference. Slide, please. So a little bit overview of our wind tunnel testing. We utilized a quarter scale model and a tunnel speed of approximately 98 feet per second. Our wing Reynolds number for the test was approximately 139,000. Something to note here, this is lower than what we would expect in flight, and therefore we do expect to see a slightly lower CL max value as well as an earlier stall angle of attack. Additionally, our test took place from an angle of attack from negative 6 degrees to 16 degrees and a side slip angle of 0 to 10. So the first part of our test was to verify our lift curve. As you can see, our predicted lift curve is in red, and the experimental one obtained from the wind tunnel data is in the dashed blue. We predicted a CL max value of 1.22 with a stall angle at 16 degrees. To our surprise, our experimental values were actually very close in terms of CL max, with a CL max of 1.21. This is partially due to the effects of the tail aiding and increasing that number. And as predicted, we did see a slight decrease in our stall angle of attack down to 12 degrees. So the other part was to verify the stability of Project Corvus. Here you can see the plots for lateral and directional stability. Both met our requirements of having a negative slope for the CL beta and roll, indicating that we're stable, as well as a positive slope in our CN beta plot, indicating that we're stable in yaw. Slide, please. Our issues that we ran into came along with our longitudinal stability. During our initial tests, we found out that the aircraft was indeed unstable in pitch, both with the tail on and the tail off in our original configuration. So this was something that we had to address and take design steps to change further. Slide, please. So in order to alleviate this problem, we came up with two solutions that we used in combination to solve our problems. That included moving the wing back in an effort to shift our aerodynamic center back, as well as adding ballast to the nose to move our CG forward. Further, our wind tunnel testing that we did, we moved the wing aft the equivalent of 4 inches on the full-scale model, as well as adding 5 pounds of ballast. Both of these in combination netted us stability and pitch as indicated by the green dashed line, which has the negative slope. Something important to note, due to structural concerns on the actual aircraft here, we were only able to move the wing back 2 inches and required only 3.9 pounds of ballast when we actually flew the aircraft. This added ballast did result in a decrease in the range and the endurance of the aircraft. However, it was not enough to prevent the aircraft from meeting the requirements. Slide, please. So I'll now pass it off to Jonathan to talk about structural design.
Thank you, Jonathan. Last slide. This is our middle frame Venn diagram in the black region here. That will be the area our aircraft can operate safely without sustaining any structural damage. And in the red region, we might sustain structural damage, and then anything above that, we will have structural failure. A few things to note here, our stall velocity of 33 knots, and our cruise velocity of 74 knots, and our dive speed of 108 knots. So, we did our preliminary structural analysis on three load-bearing members, which are our upper longeron, lower longeron, and forward spar. We tested those up to 4.5 G loading. As you can see here, our carbon fiber is made out of a circular cross section. Our wing spar is made out of a circular cross section carbon fiber tube with a failure stress of 284 KSI. And from our calculations, we found a maximum applied stress of 154 KSI, and that gives us a margin of safety of 0.84, which is a positive margin of safety, which states our wing spar will not fail under our loading. We did similar things for the upper and lower longerons, and you can see there turned out to be a positive margin of safety for that too. And to further confirm our preliminary structural analysis, we conducted a final element model analysis of our fuselage structure. And we learned welding our fuselage structure specifically for aluminum 6061T6, it will cause up to 40% material degradation around the affected area. We took that into account into our analysis, and we fixed our fuselage by the wing spar points, and we distributed the load according to our payload layout. And this is our result for from our structural analysis. We have a maximum deflection of about 0.4 inches with equivalent stress of 22,000 PSI. Even with the welding, we have a margin of safety of 0.08 that stays our structure, meets the structural requirement. Thank you. We conducted a wing structural test to verify that our wing meets the 4.5 G requirement, structural requirement. We tested to 2.5 Gs or equivalent to 66 degrees bank angle. We didn't go all the way to 4.5 G's because we wanted to have a flight test article to test aerodynamics and stability. And we constrained our fuselage and all degrees of freedom, and we distributed the loads using strength lift spanwise lift distribution. And we instrumented the wing at the wingtip and at the interface, at the outboard inboard interface point with two displacement transducers to measure displacement. Thank you. And as you can see here, this is our results from going from 1G up to 2.5 Gs, and then stepping out by half a G increment. And we have a maximum deflection for 2.5 Gs at the wingtip of 4.25 inches. But something to note here, going from 1G to 1.5 Gs, there is a huge jump in wingtip deflection. That is due to the load from the skin not being transferred to the spar right away. The load was taken by the foam core and it deflected before the spars were handling the load. After 1.5 Gs, the increment decreased significantly. Okay. And comparing our results from our preliminary analysis and our test results for 2.5 Gs, you can see there's a huge difference. This is mainly due to the load transfer issue I just mentioned from the skin to the spars. The foam carried the initial load and deformed before the load was transferred to the spars, like I said. And this could be corrected by adding additional ribs, especially in the inboard section of the wing. And we determined, we stayed in the elastic region. For our preliminary and the final model, we never exceeded the yield stress. So we were in the elastic region. For our structural test, we measured the displacement before and after, loading and unloading to make sure that it deflected back to its original position. Sorry. Now I'll hand it off. I'll hand it off to Aiden to talk about avionics layout.
Thank you, Yann. So while the Corvus design makes use of a pre-existing jump knowledge with the servos already situated, we still need to decide where and how to install the servos used to control the ailerons. We opted to put these on the inside of the wing, attached to a rib, and I'll leave a section of the external skin panel detachable to allow access to the servos for repair or replacement should that need arise. Next slide, please. So for our simplified avionics, we have our standard transmitter and receiver. Next slide, please. But because of the number of servos that we have in the Corvus design, we opted to use a power controlling unit, or power conditioning unit, to distribute the power directly from the batteries to the servos in order to take some of the load off of our receiver and control unit. Next slide, please. Here you can see the layout of the servos, color-coded according to their channels. On this slide, there are two servos that were not in the original design, one of which is the steerable nose gear servo that is toward the front of the aircraft. After we tested the steerable nose gear, we found that at idle, the engine produced so much thrust that we needed to implement a braking system in order to meet our landing requirements and also to have the Corvus controllable while taxiing on the ground. As such, we implemented a braking system toward the aft section of the aircraft, and you can see toward the rear there is the brake servo. Next slide, please. Here are some of the details of our braking system. We have the brake servo installed on the underside of the fuselage near the engine that drives a rod that then moves the brake hinge to put friction on the wheels. When we tested this the first time, we had an issue where the rods actually came free and intersected the propeller that we had at that time. As such, we came up with a retaining bracket that would prevent that issue from ever happening again, should that become an issue possibly in the future. Next slide, please. I would like to hand it off to Derek to talk about the production.
So there's a significant amount of manufacturing required for Project Corvus, including the construction of the wind tunnel model and the fabrication of test specimens for materials and structural tests, and of course the construction of the prototype model. So the prototype is divided down into five sub-assemblies. We have the fuselage, the inboard wings, and the outboard wings, all of which our team constructed. We also integrated a power plant system consisting of the DLE-85 engine, its propeller and fuel system, and an empennage as previously stated, was from another team, which we incorporated into our design. So we started with the construction of the longeron, with the fuselage, excuse me. It was composed of three longerons and four bulkheads, along with a bottom plate. All these were made of 6061 aluminum. We welded the longerons to the bulkheads and fastened the bottom skin up into the lower longerons with screws. The next step was the attachment of the wing integration brackets. These brackets were also welded out of 6061 aluminum and were fastened to the side of the longerons. They're fastened with bolts through the top and rivets through the bottom longerons. And what isn't shown here is that we used the spars for alignment to make sure that our wings were correctly aligned with the fuselage. We didn't have a weird sweep or an angle in the wings. Next, we installed the inboard sections of the wing spars. These slid through the wing integration brackets, and they were epoxied in place. The construction of the wings was over a foam core cut into the Clark Y airfoil shape and using plywood ribs. We then formed a wet layup of two plies of carbon fiber over that, and once it had cured, we cut pockets down through the top surface of the wing to install empennage joint. Once that was installed, we then coated the inboard spars with epoxy and slid the wings over for a permanent attachment to the fuselage. The outboard wings followed a similar manufacturing process, except in this case, the spars were already embedded in the foam prior to the wet layup. After that was completed, we then epoxied in wing spar joints, which slid inside the main spars. And these allowed us to slide the inboard wings into the outboard wings, or the outboard wings into the inboard wings, which were fastened with bolts through the top surface of the skin. We constructed landing gear by modifying a Robart nose gear for RC aircraft. We created an extension adapter to change its length to match the main gear. And the main gear was constructed of 23 plies of carbon fiber in a wet layup over an aluminum mold. This was assembled and it was installed to the fuselage with bolts, the nose gear bolted to the forward bulkhead, and the main gear bolted up onto the lower longerons. The next step was the integration of the empennage. This simply included moving the booms over the empennage joints and running bolts down through that interface. The engine was then installed with its propeller, and this was just bolted to the aft bulkhead. Next step was the fabrication and installation of our fuselage skin. Our fuselage skin was two plies of E-glass and a wet layup over a foam mandrel. And it was in two sections. We had an aft skin and a forward skin. The aft skin gave us access to the fuel and fuel tank, and the forward skin gave us access to our avionics. So the aft skin slid over the front of the fuselage and was fastened around the wing spars and to the longerons via screws. The forward skin, same construction and same attachment, just slid over the fuselage and was fastened screws again to the upper and lower longerons. We created a nose cone from a plastic dome, which is actually for a security camera, which we modified. We added a flat bottom to it to match the rest of the fuselage, and we added attachment tabs that allowed us to screw it into the longerons. All right, that concludes the assembly of the Corvus prototype. Throughout this whole process, we kept records of the weight and balance to make sure that we were on track to meet our estimates. And now Kevin will talk about what our final weight and balance were.
Thank you, Garrett. Excellent. So for our weight and balance, we broke down the project into components and listed the CG and location of each, which gave our total CG of about 26 inches back from the front bulkhead. Next slide. To compare the CG with the aerodynamic center, you can get the static margin, which came out to about 0.3 with full fuel. And as we burn fuel, it shifts back to 0.24 with 1 pound reserve. Next slide. As a weight comparison of what we estimated to what we actually have here, is very close. We had about a half a pound difference. The biggest part of that was with the fuselage after adding a couple of components such as the brakes. The weight went up to about 8 pounds. So we had a total weight at the end with full fuel of 44 pounds, which is about 9 pounds under what our requirement was. Next slide. And I'll pass it off to Joanna Moore for the taxi and test flights.
So we can conducted 3 taxi tests here on campus at the RC field, and the primary purpose of conducting these taxi tests before flight tests was A, to make sure that everything that we had built worked, all of our flight control surfaces deflected, our nose wheel steering worked, but also to demonstrate that our aircraft was controllable on the ground at a range of speeds. So this is our very first taxi test. You can see that the aircraft is controllable, it steers pretty well. However, this was before we added wheel brakes, and we quickly realized that even at engine idle, we could not stop this thing. Friction was not sufficient. So as Aiden discussed, we decided to add wheel brakes, slide please. So further testing showed that our brakes worked quite well. One thing you can see there is it got a little bit choppy. That's because on this was at the Chino Valley RC field on a paved runway. That smoother surface, it showed that our nose wheel steering was a little bit too sensitive, but you can still see that it turns quite well. Slide, please. So we also conducted a transmitter range test here on campus on the ground to see how far away our transmitter would work. We got a distance of about 800 feet, although that is going through trees and terrain, so we expect that in the air, our range is gonna be a little bit further. So based on our taxi test results, we figured out that everything worked once we added the wheel brakes. We could control it on the ground at a range of speeds, and we had the sufficient range with the transmitter to go ahead and go to flight test. Please. So with our flight test purpose, we wanted to figure out what our takeoff and landing ground roll distance is to make sure we can meet that 500-foot requirement. We wanted to show that our aircraft was stable and controllable during flight, that we could perform maneuvers such as a 2G turn, and figure out what our aircraft speed is. One thing you'll notice is that we didn't include anything on fuel consumption here because, as Chris mentioned, we're using a very different engine with a much higher fuel burn that won't be comparable to the fuel-injected engine we would use on the production model, but due to our budget, we couldn't afford that for this one. Slide, please. So this actually wraps up the end of our successful taxi test. Until the end of the runway. He was probably able to do it earlier, but he waited to make sure he had extra speed. The runway there is also on about a 10-degree slope, which did improve our speed going downhill. We are confident, based on that test, that we would be able to do our 500-foot takeoff ground roll. So the feedback that we received from our pilot was that the aircraft ailerons and rudder were nice and responsive. However, the elevator was a little bit mushy, and he needed full elevator deflection to hold altitude and turns. Based on this photo, which does assume that the camera was held level, we got a maximum recorded bank angle of about 67 degrees. So that would be around a 2G turn. Slide, please. The Chino Valley Police Department also came out and used their radar guns to record a maximum speed of about 76 knots. Slide, please. So in summary, we think that our aircraft would meet our speed and takeoff and landing distance requirements. Now, you're probably looking at that landing distance, which is about 1,500 times better than that of an F4 under similar conditions. You're probably wondering how we achieve that with predicted landing distance of 200 feet. So this next slide will show you how. Let's see that again. So what actually happened during our flight test is there's a little bit of a miscommunication with the pilot. We had planned to do a taxi test on the paved runway, stop, refuel the aircraft, weigh our fuel tank, so we knew how much fuel was on board. But the pilot was like, this thing taxis great, let's take off. He took off with less than full fuel. We ended up running out of fuel and he wasn't able to make it back to the runway. And this was the result. On the next slide here, you can see our nose gear actually sheared right off. So the nose gear came off and the nose cone was a little bit cracked, which we replaced with a spare part. But that was the only damage to the aircraft. Everything else actually worked, even all the servos. So great job to our production team for building a really robust aircraft. Slide, please. So based on our flight and taxi tests, in order to improve our elevator control authority, we'd like to increase the overall horizontal tail size or move it into the prop wash to get better airflow over it. We also, based on our taxi test, decided that wheel brakes are absolutely necessary. And you'll notice on here that the wires are a little bit out in the airflow, which would have some negative effects on our drag. So on the production model, we would definitely want that secured to the back of the main gear to minimize that. And we'd also want to reduce the sensitivity of our nose wheel steering to improve control on paved surfaces. Slide, please. So I'm going to go ahead and hand it off to Kendall Jones to discuss our program summary.
Thank you, Joanna. So despite all of the hands-on and fun manufacturing work that went into building this project, there was indeed some paperwork behind the scenes. Primarily, we had a large program plan. This program plan is condensed a lot so that it can fit on the screen in a way that you guys can read it easily. But it does highlight some of the key concepts of that plan. You notice in the middle of the semester, we have a lot of tasks running simultaneously. Those tasks included testing, verifications, our manufacturing plan, which was very, very well made by our manufacturing leader, Garrett. And we also had a lot of redesigns that actually had to happen in the middle of the semester in order for this to happen productively and efficiently in the time frame that was given. Because of all of those parallel tasks and being able to coordinate those, we were able to run this project successfully. I won't say into the ground, but we were able to run this project successfully and have a really good conclusion. We also did keep a fairly accurate course of time loading this semester. The hourly rates were provided by Professor Zwick for different uses of our time, including personal development, which was class time, but it's still a good meeting time in which we can come together as a team and work on different aspects of our project. Obviously, it didn't take long to realize that once that manufacturing plan would hit the ground, that we would have really steep runnings in being able to produce this plane and make this project happen. So in the middle of our semester, we did take a really big leap of hours. However, the things that we did not assume would happen were some of our exceedingly long testings. Our testings did not go as perfectly as we hoped. We had to rerun our wind tunnel test multiple times in order to be confident in our model. We also had to go through a lot of different material testing scenarios based off of just having provided material. And those happened on later in the semester. And because of all these different testings, we did exceed our budget at the beginning of the semester. However, because of our awesome manufacturing plan, we were actually able to come out under budget at the end of the semester, if barely. We do have a small overview of where our budget went. We are really, really grateful to Amber Riddle for a lot of the facilities that they provided, including the carbon fiber. As you can tell by our massively ply landing gear, we went through a lot of carbon fiber to produce this. Actually, I think that landing gear might have taken more carbon fiber than the whole wing structure. Was it 21 plies? 23 plies. We did some minor estimates on that, although we do know that Invisible does have lots of its carbon fiber supplied from other sources. They were able to let us use a lot of that. We also did use a lot of carbon fiber in testing. We were not severely confident that we could hit those wings on the first try. A lot of that testing happened last semester, but that budget is included in this model as well. We did make budget. big thank you to all of our professors that helped us out in this project. Turn it over to Cooper to wrap up.
Thank you. So these are some of the people that helped make our project possible. So we want to help both on campus and off campus. Here's some of the memorable things that we know about our professors that were able to help us. Try to get them to flow through. Any questions? So that will conclude our final design review for Project Corvus. Thank you all for coming to our presentation, and thank you to the panelists for coming down here. I know a lot of you aren't from around this area, so we appreciate to have you here and give us feedback. With that said, do you guys have any questions for us? And while you think of some, I'd like the team to come up so we can all answer.
Slide 14-ish, talking a little bit about wind tunnel. So I'm curious, did you think about Reynolds number matching? And did you try, if I remember right, I think there's something about trip strips that you can try to get Reynolds number matching. Go ahead.
Yeah, we did discuss that with our wind tunnel professor here on campus. However, he recommended against using trip strips without having more data about where exactly to place it, because that could affect the transition.
Okay. I mean, if I remember the Reynolds number equation, if you hold Reynolds number constant, you can just change x, right? Your x critical or something like that to figure that out.
We should definitely look into that further.
Okay. Yeah, sorry, it's been a while. I might be wrong. As far as your wind tunnel test description, I would like to have seen a slide talking a little bit about which wind tunnel you used. I think that's the 24 by 36, if I remember the size. But a little bit more description of how you went about the testing. Particularly, I would have been curious, any kind of statistical rigor. Did you attempt the points multiple times? Do you have any flavor of confidence in your values? Any of that sort of thing?
Yes, we actually conducted these tests multiple times. We conducted hysteresis tests as well.
Huh.
And in order to, since we were getting somewhat unpredicted or unexpected values for our CM, for our pitching moment coefficients, we also built an additional structure to go out with set weights at set distances from the balance so that we could verify with hand calculations that the moments provided by the balance were accurate, and they came out very close, within 1%.
Okay.
So we were pretty confident in values. The actual moment values from the state balance.
Yeah, what I would suggest is the next time you do detail, which is probably never, but it would be really helpful to kind of focus a little bit on some of that.
Okay.
And help me understand how good the data are.
Yeah.
And what really to read out of the results.
Okay.
So kind of a suggestion. You guys spent a lot of slides, and obviously you spent an enormous amount of time making that thing into a real-life flying air vehicle, which is incredible. You might have been able to cut down on that number of slides and spend more time on the data. Just an idea, it's weird because you spent so much of your lives and your time and your effort designing that or putting that thing together, but from the engineering perspective, we just dig into the data and assume that somehow magically the article comes into being. So maybe you can maybe rebalance slightly. The last thing, and then I'm going to stop talking, is test discipline is so hard. And it sounds like your test pilot got a little excited and kind of leaned forward, more forward than you were expecting. One suggestion with that, and something that we've had a lot of success with in, I've come from Air Force flight tests, is having some flavor of a test card. So writing down, here's what we want to do today, and here's where we're going to take breaks and refuel, and here's how we're going to march through the whole thing. Did you have any, the term that we use is test conductor. So someone who was the kind of main point of contact and the one who was talking into the pilot's ear about, okay, you did this, now we're going to do this. Or was it kind of just the whole group of you guys suggesting what the next
That was actually my job.
Oh, cool. Okay. Great.
And so one thing is that after he took off with less than full fuel, we didn't know exactly how much fuel was on the aircraft and how long it could stay up.
Yeah.
We were concerned that if he did come in to land immediately, that if it were to crash, we couldn't perform any other tests that day.
Right.
So we did want to get a little bit of data up in the air.
Absolutely.
And we actually asked him to land. He came around. He wasn't lined up with the runway, and on his go around, turning downwind, he ran out of fuel.
It was very close. Yeah. So that's perfect segue. Slide 76, and this is the last thing I'll say. Your first flight test purpose is to determine the takeoff and landing ground roll distance, which implies that you need to land. Generally, whenever in flight test, we're doing first flights of anything, the primary objective is to land safely. And everything else, even if we didn't get the data, whatever, now we have a test article that we can go and do flight two with.
Yeah.
Highly suggest that be really the focus of any time you're trying to go fly, is make sure that you can land safely, so that you can go out and do it again and get more data.
Yeah.
Right. Holy cow, you guys really worked hard, so high five and congratulations.
Thank you.
Yes, very good job. Definitely feel your pain, both on the presentation and the testing aspect of it. So you guys mentioned the 20K camera that's going on. Did you guys simulate that with ballast, or just take that out of the equation and just use the GoPro?
So, sir, we have the GoPro and the nose cone for now. That was our active camera for our test flight. Then this yellow mess, I don't know if you can see it from there, but there's a yellow mess behind the jet head.
It's not
going to
fit back.
Yeah, it's not
going to
fit on the table very well.
We'll hold it.
Yeah.
So, right here we have the yellow steel bars just in the AR camera and other payload that would be in the front.
And there's an array of simulated payloads, including extra batteries, the autonomous flight systems, and extra telemetry that would go in here, and that's simulated by the yellow steel masses.
Okay, so you had extra avionics equipment as well?
We would have extra avionics for the autonomous flight. And that yellow mass is the kind of center of gravity of all of those components put together.
And so what about external alignment?
There would be no extra external other than the camera would have a little ball coming out of the bottom. Instead of a flat plate on the bottom, it would be a circular ball.
Okay.
Popping out.
Yeah, I agree with Chris. I would like to see a little more of the engineering aspect of it. Although the integration and the assembly is feels like it takes forever, consumes a lot of time. I guess the other thing that I was worried about flipping through the assembly stuff is between your fasteners. And it seems like you guys have a lot of single point of failure points on the airframe. Do you guys think about that at all?
So we had done a rough analysis on the fasteners, and we saw that their bearing would have been much higher than any of the loads we would expect on the aircraft. And that the membranes would actually fail before the fasteners would, but the forces required for that to fail as well were pretty high. They were in the tens of kips, which we weren't expecting on our aircraft. So our main focus was making sure that they didn't vibrate out, and we prevented that with the three locks. We had Loctite applied, torque, and then locking nuts made with inserts.
Most fasteners are redundant in at least one fashion, especially like any flight critical components like these wings. We have a fastener that goes through the front and rear spar. That way, if one fastener does fail, the other one still has a chance of holding on. Even with, like, engine has four. Anything on the skin has at least four. And our landing gear all have at least four as well.
So kind of the great thing about UAVs right now is FAA doesn't really have guidelines. So you can pretty much do whatever you want as long as you can justify it and you don't have accidents that cost money. So why did you guys go with a load limit of 4.5?
So the 4.5 number comes from 80% of our maximum load, which would be 6 Gs. And that's kind of like what we'd expect in a really bad crash or something like that, is that 6G number. And we wanted to make sure we could survive just about anything. So if we could survive up to 4.5 Gs, that gives us the extra margin to at least have a salvageable plane at 6 Gs.
There's also a CFR requirement.
And that was part of the CFR requirement.
Okay. So I guess I would like to see more along the lines of engineering data, is like kind of what you're expecting and what you guys actually executed to. I guess more of the flight test card and points you guys hit on, what you guys were able to achieve. But didn't really go into what, how that was done or what the detailed results were. Does that make sense? So time to compute, time to complete, 6 hours max was the requirement. You guys did 4 hours. That was projected performance. You guys have some sort of actual performance. So how long were you guys actually up in the air? What was your fuel consumption when you guys were flying around, even though it wasn't for the actual engine that you guys want to eventually go to? But kind of that type of data still gives a background as to how the overall aircraft is performing.
That was a part that came out of our flight test that was a little bit tricky, because we didn't get a chance to refuel and weigh our fuel before he got here. So we couldn't really estimate that accurately, and we didn't want to put up garbage numbers, essentially.
Okay, me and you have the same problem. Operating error happens all the time. What, I guess, just my curiosity is, what was the 20K imager? You guys answer that?
Do you remember?
Okay, do you know what the imaging quality is? New Year's value?
I can't remember off the top of my head, sorry.
And then what is your guys' mission profile look like? How far AGL are you guys required to fly as a complete mission?
FAA requirements do exist for small UAVs that are 50 pounds. That requires it to fly under 400 feet.
500
feet. Under 500 feet above ground level, so we picked 400 feet, kind of with our altimeter to say we're staying at 400 feet above ground level. That way, if we do go 10 to 15 feet above that, doesn't matter. And the other requirements were that we couldn't go above 100 miles per hour ground speed. So we have our GPS system in there to calculate kind of how fast are you going relative to ground speed, and try and keep the cruise speed at about 74 knots to keep the mission time at 4 hours.
Okay.
So that's how the whole system would come together for a production model. Our prototype couldn't really test all of that, so we did the best we could with what we had, essentially.
Oh, thanks a lot. It was fun hearing the pains that we've been experiencing.
Thank you for your feedback.
Sometimes it's nice to know you're not the only one going through specific issues. So, well done. I especially like the process you guys follow with an RFP, defining your requirements, going to tests, documenting your assembly. That's pretty realistic. It's almost like someone had done it before. I really like to see that. That was pretty realistic to the work I do. So skipping over what's already been said, we'll just start with slide 26. So I was a little confused about this. So is this a actual wing? Is this the same wing on there?
Yes.
Oh, okay. That makes more sense.
We mounted our wing upside down and we constrained the fuselage.
Okay, because I was wondering, partly I was wondering why you didn't test a failure, and partly I was wondering about the line setup, because I just couldn't get it. But if it was the real wing, that makes sense why it's supported the way it is. Okay.
So we didn't have the budget to test something for failure.
Fair enough. And it's a lot of work to make a second wing. When we were in AIAA, we would typically build two spars and just work the spar. Slide 42. So this was good to show your process. It really clarified how you guys built it. But I agree it could have been cut down on. It's just, I really did like to see that, because that was very detailed. And that, I mean, that's kind of what you need for an assembly procedure. So that was really good. 74, please.
So I don't know if you guys were restricted by something, but could you find a clear line of sight, like, did someone stand on top of AC1 and transmit down there? Like, is there another way you could have done this other than through trees?
Probably. The way we were doing it is we were just having our test pilot kind of walk in increments and then control and see if it was going. So if we had it at a set location, you know, we wouldn't know how much shorter, how much farther we could go.
Okay.
It's just kind of how we decided to run it.
Okay. It just seemed like that would be something that would be really important to know before you went in fluid, because if you get out of range, you know,
so yeah, 800 feet is our worst case scenario, essentially.
Okay.
Actually, the test of that, I think, during the flight test, he was well over 800 feet away.
Yeah, but that was just my concern, because he flies out there, and then you suddenly lose connection, you go to the ground, and lose plane. So I was just concerned about that. Slide 81, please. So is there any way to validate your predicted values?
Not on our first flight test. If we had been able to fly it again, we would have asked the pilot to bring the nose up a little bit sooner. We were limited by using a runway that was on a slope, so, you know, we could do some math and...
Okay. Yeah, I just wanted to know if there was any other way you guys saw to validate that other than another test. Slide 84. You guys do have a robustness requirement, right? You probably met it. Slide 89, please. Was it 89? I think it was 88. Yeah, I missed the slide. Anyways, kind of a sarcastic comment on what I was saying earlier. So those rear struts are, what, 22 plies?
23.
So what's wrong with aluminum or steel?
That's
a lot of work to make that many plies, is all I'm saying.
It was a consideration of, there was an aluminum gear left over from the previous team, and I think it was quarter inch, and it wasn't even close to strong enough because of the span that we're running on the gear. Okay. You could just held it and just bend it right down. So.
Okay, that's a good answer. It's just 23 plies.
It was hours. It was hours.
Yeah, so that's what I was just wondering, like, wouldn't it be easier to go sheet metal and bend it, but...
You guys need to go look at that meme here. That thing is amazing.
Pretty much professional.
It's
amazing. Maybe you should have tested it.
We made two versions of the land gear, one with half cuts, the other one was a full cut, and that's this one. The half cuts ended up with a half inch thick center section. And we couldn't use that one because the curvature on the top meant it was too thin for the flat area to connect to our fuselage. So we could have tested that one to failure, but we could bend it all the way flat, and it still wouldn't break. So we'd have to bend it around something to break it, and we couldn't figure out any way to break it.
Properly testing things is a real challenge, because you want to be as realistic as you can. Okay, overall, good presentation. I thought it was really good from a test and manufacturing standpoint, but definitely needed more data. Another thing I would like to have seen was more of a summary of the requirements, like what you had at the beginning in your conclusion. And I was reading through your backup slides as well and saw that you guys had a lot of good information in there that we're going to see in the presentation. So, I know you guys have it, which just made me bring it up. So overall, very good presentation. Good job, you guys.
Thank you.
So yeah, I know how difficult these DBF things are, so seeing one come together like this is just incredibly impressive. I did DBF when I was here, and it wasn't for a class, and I just remember some of the issues we had along with some of the issues that a lot of the capstone teams had. I think pretty much everybody had chronic landing gear problems. So I was just curious as to what additional measures you guys took to mitigate any of those, because I didn't have anything about, you know, if you did a drop test or not. I didn't have anything about any sort of handcuffs or structural verification on the landing gear, and that's been a huge problem for teams in the past. So what kind of work did you guys do with that?
The truth of the matter is, and I'll just come out and be honest about it, our original plan was to use an aluminum gear. And the carbon fiber started out just kind of the let's see what happens. There, unless somebody's down here, to not to my knowledge, there was no actual structural analysis performed on this exact carbon gear, because when we were doing all of our preliminary design, it was done with aluminum. This kind of, we just had it, we tested it, we played with it, we kind of did some, you know, just drop testing, just holding it and dropping it, and it seemed to be the best thing to provide us some sort of suspension on landing, other than just something being rigid, and is able to hold the weight.
Okay.
And then something we discovered from those drop tests was it would flex out too far to the point where the propeller could hit the ground. So we added that cable across the bottom to prevent it from flexing too far. It still has the springiness in the suspension. You can see Tappy rolling around, bouncing around. But on that drop test, we discovered propeller can't hit the ground, so cable was our kind of quick solution to it, and it ended up working just fine.
Let's go to slide 29. So I know a lot of these projects are limited to what you can do. It's usually you get lucky assuming that the aircraft's gonna be stiff enough to build it out of all composites, but I remember there were times when that wasn't the case and you'd run into aeroelasticity issues with parts of the airframe. Not so much like flutter, but you know, a lot of control surface rotation type stuff from Buffett and things like that just because the servos aren't stiff enough. So did you guys factor that at all into your servo selection? And I'm wondering if you did any considerations on aeroelastic stuff that could have gone wrong, because I know you point out why these preliminary test results are off, but the thing that concerns me is your aircraft is clearly a lot less stiff than you thought it was going to be.
So we didn't do any aeroelasticity kind of analysis. The reason for that drop we did notice is just because the foam deformed, so our spar wasn't taking the load as we expected it would. If we had added a rib to this inner part where it was deforming the foam, it would probably have shown closer to our analysis. We saw from after the 1.5G the increments more matched what we thought it would be, so we assume that was the deformation problem.
Yeah, the thing I would be more worried about here, I think that part I said it was more the control surface rotation type of stuff because of that, the servos not being stiff enough. And I see, probably got lucky there, but the reason that I'm making such a big deal out of that is because you guys flew really fast. I think this is one of the, in terms of DVF flying, this might be one of the fastest ones that I've ever seen. So at that point, you kind of have to factor those things in more, but are you going to?
So the servos we used were extremely high torque servos, so once there's power going to them, they literally won't budge even if you grab them and try and do that. So once they have power running through them, they hold position very well.
Chris, you might want to flip that wing over and show what you did to the gaps between the aileron and the wing.
Okay, and then for the flight, because we have heard issues with the buffeting, we could add tape from here to here, and it would fill this crack and prevent air from flying through the bottom, going through the top. And that kind of reduced the issues that we had with any kind of wind buffeting.
Okay, that's good. Good answer. So, another thing, let's see, what was that? So, yeah, as Chris had mentioned earlier, test discipline standpoint. I think you kind of mentioned why nobody called terminate after you guys got airborne. The other thing was, you kind of have to consider the max safe speed you guys were going to go. And it just kind of brought up the point of verifying that G that you're going to get to. I was just wondering how you're monitoring these values, what kind of, especially that was particularly curious about how you knew you were going to get to 2G. So I know you knew after the fact you measured the 66 degree bank angle, but real time, I was curious as how you knew you were going to get that 2Gs.
We didn't have any way other than visual estimates, and it was just the pilot making these turns.
Our pilot was not very considerative as a test pilot, and I mean, it was almost more of a joyride, kind of as you're mentioning. We did try to go over a test plan at the beginning of the flight, and we did try to verify with them that they understood our parameters, but we had a harder time communicating once the flight started.
Okay.
And one of his other comments along those lines is he also said that we didn't have our logos on at the time of the flight, and he said that once it's in the sky, it was really hard to see at what angle it was going, so he wasn't really able to track how far he was making when he was making his turn. We probably would have placarded it to be less than 60 degrees, but we saw that it went anyways.
Last quick question. So for your, some test maneuvers that you did, I was wondering if you had, besides just kind of qualitative comments, I was wondering if you guys considered using any HQRs, Cooper Harbor ratings, for some of the tasks that you guys performed.
We considered having a Cooper Harbor scale, but we didn't bring it with, and we were hoping to modify one to be more for a UAV instead of a full plane.
Okay. Yeah, well, overall, great job. It's pretty awesome.
Thank you.
Comments, we have questions from the guests?
I think you guys did a fantastic job. I just have one comment. Oh, that's okay. I don't never have. One comment for Joanna, and I'm looking at your airplane out there in the dirt. I just want to assure you that if it had been the F-4, we would have made it back to a safe landing. And also, you can't trust the Chino Valley Police Department to convert from statute miles per hour to nautical miles per hour.
We did that conversion.
You did that. Okay. Thank you. Your wind tunnel testing, that test, we've had problems with that CM Alpha for that forever. And the problem is that you have to put in a X and a Y C, or an X and a Z CG of that airplane, or of the model, not of the airplane, of the model, where you have to put them both in. And that's the problem that you're having with your CM Alpha, and we've had that forever. So, yeah, showing that it's unstable in the wind tunnel doesn't mean that it's not going to be unstable when you fly it.
So we did actually test by putting in different CG locations for the model Z and Y, and we didn't get a very big change in our output values.
How did you measure your ZCG?
So we took a piece of angle iron, we tried to balance it, which is a little bit difficult when the whole thing is together. So we ended up actually doing it in two pieces. On our wind tunnel model, the empennage is removed where the spar is attached to the wing. So we took it apart, measured the ZCG, which is a lot easier with it in two pieces, and then summed them together. Get the overall
situation. Yeah, it's not an easy process to get that.
Believe me, we did it many times.
If we could ever find out what is in that program and what it calculates, then we could modify it and come up with something worthwhile, but we can't.
I wanted to point out, too, I can't believe you guys forgot about the CDR. Middle of October, we poured over wind tunnel data, structural analysis data over. We had a huge review that was the gate before we could actually start building that airplane. That is where all of that data that you guys were looking for was delivered. And that was all delivered before this build started. Okay, so apologies that it wasn't here, but that's where you would have seen
this. This presentation was more focused on results and kind of what happened versus how we got there.
I know I have a question, follow-up from last semester. You may recall brought up an issue with the wing airfoil choice, and that it probably would not affect your takeoff distance, but would most definitely affect your ground roll for landing. And so my question is was this crash intentional to subvert reporting a long
ground? I can neither confirm nor deny.
All right, no, great job, guys. I do have one serious aerodynamic question, which is that your test pilot reported that your elevator control was mushy. How would you, obviously we're done, how would you rectify that?
Okay, so our best solution that we came up with was to take the existing horizontal tail and drop it into the prop wash, so you have constant airflow over it the entire time. A big problem we ran into, even with the wind tunnel testing, was as you nose up, or like try and turn, there would be a large blockage caused by both the wing and the fuselage over this horizontal tail, and it would cause a lot of choppy and unsteady air to go over it, resulting in kind of weird stalls or anything related to that, where the Elevator no longer can control it.
Well, Chris, you want to or do you want me?
So
you're going to put that horizontal tail in the prop flush and have a continuous flow?
Well, my concern is on landing, because landing, I hope you're going to pull power back, and if you don't have the elevator authority to flare, then same.
I want to hear the other one.
So then the other part of that is this elevator is actually oversized, and the horizontal tail is oversized for this aircraft. It's already larger than what's needed for something of this size. And kind of the biggest reason that we're running into early stalls was the wing blocks a lot of the air flowing over that.
But when you put that down in the prop wash, because of the prop wash itself, you got different angles of attack on your horizontal tail. So that's not, the P factor there is gonna, yeah, whatever.
But the other solution, so we had actually talked about
this. That's not a good solution.
He recommended that change because he said even though it would be not the best airflow, it would still be better than none.
Who recommended that change?
Dr. Trout, the wind tunnel. And then, yeah.
He doesn't have to fly it.
He also recommended that we could increase the size of the elevator, but that would have taken a significant change on our
future. Monish, you wanted to add something?
Oh, yeah. So definitely for the future recommendation, we would increase the size of the length of the boom of horizontal tail. And the thing was here was it's the bigger size of the elevator. Not elevator, I mean the horizontal tail. There should be an angle of attack. It's a symmetrical airfoil. So due to downwash effect, so at the zero level angle of attack, the horizontal tail sees a different angle of attack. So that was one of the main reasons CM alpha was being like nose up. So if you increase the angle of attack and can create downwash and make those changes, we don't have to add ballast, and that would be how it would come back to its proper position.
Okay, process check here. We are 10 minutes away from the next presentation starting. In order to get you guys time to go get pizza, take a bathroom break, whatever, I think we're going to end questions right now.